everyone. Welcome back to Magic TV on the Magic Cruise. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with
Patrick Chapin.
There we go. We have an excellent top eight list right here.
A perfect one, you might say.
Yeah, long and hard to get to this one. The exact opposite of the way we usually do things here. We have the top eight, would you say most perfectly designed, most perfectly...
The most perfect Magic cards.
There you go.
From a design perspective, or else we would just say Jace the Mind Sculptor eight times. But yes, the eight best designed, the most perfectly designed Magic cards.
Exactly. And we're going to start off his list with playing a little Corset Survivor, really. I mean, Giant Spider's been there for almost 20 years.
Yes. And the beautiful thing about Giant Spider, and he kind of represents a whole bunch of other creatures as well, but he's the perfect example of them because he shows off an element of the color pie. He has very good definition. He's a very good top-down design. But he's also... The context change. Things change. You know, cards come and go, and the rules change, and everything else seems to be changing. But he's always right there, and he's always doing his job at just the right power level.
Again, 20 years later, you think, you know, between Alpha to M13, there would have been enough change in Magic where you'd look back at any of the cards printed and be like, wow, this is either too powerful or just not good enough. Like, I'm either never gonna get a chance to play with this card because I won't be allowed to, or I would never choose to play this card. And Giant Spider has survived the test of time. It's beautiful in every level. Again, you look at it and it does what you expect it to do. It can't fly, but it can stop the things that can fly. It has power, it has more toughness, it's chilling by the web. It all makes sense.
Yeah, and just, if you were picturing a giant spider, obviously we're kind of anchored because it exists, but it's hard to imagine Giant Spider any other way, right? Like, 2/4 is big enough where it feels like it's actually, like it can eat grizzly bears. That's how big of a spider it is.
Yeah, there have been many, I mean, obviously there have been many riffs on the Giant Spider since the original. In canopies, ones that did some spitting, ancient ones, so on and so forth. But that initial concept has led to a very perfect Magic card. Number 7 on our list, we have our only black card, and more or less fittingly a removal spell, because black in the early days was, again, very polarized. Either the cards were very, 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 very good, or very, very bad.
A lot of the things, black used to kind of be the second color besides blue in terms of it was good for all the wrong reasons.
We learned something by doing this list, too, is that blue and black, for a long time, that's it. It's hard to find the perfect card in this regard.
Yeah, it's not clear that blue isn't still just completely unhealthy and just bad, but...
With almost 20 years of Magic, we were unable to really find good answers.
So, Doomblade is the black card I'd say is the perfect black card. So many of the most iconic black cards... they're not quite at the right power level. You know, like, Demonic Tutor is too good, and Diabolic Tutor is just a little too weak. And the ones that are... Even the iconic creatures like Hypnotic Spectre, there's a lot of unhealthy things, like random discard or drawbacks, you know, like creatures that do damage to yourself, you know? And that's fine, like, that's part of Black's color pie, but it's really hard, like, Night's Whisper, Juzam Jin, those are both beautiful and pretty high up on the list. But it's hard for me to call it the perfect card when the vast majority of people are going to be turned off to it despite
right.
how good it is because that is a drawback.
Again, you look at the black philosophy. You're paying life to do things. Well, that most players aren't really interested in that. And if you are paying life to do them, they're probably pretty powerful effects. You know, you have discard, which is an effect of black, and that's not really the most fun or engaging mechanic.
Not for a lot of people. But Doomblade, like killing a creature, that's very few people... love to do things more than just like play creatures and kill creatures. They just love that type of thing. Doomblade looks sweet to everybody, but it's actually good. It's at a power level where it's actually good in tournament play, and but it's not oppressively good. It's not like Swords to Plowshares good, you know? And it's actually, I think that Doomblade is a better design than Murder. It's close. Like, Murder is the new card from M13, 1BB, instant destroy target creature. That card's been around in existence, called Murder, but forever. It's never been legal or printed or anything, but I think there's always been you sort of know that someday you're going to make that card. And Doomblade, though, I think is a more perfect place because Doomblade is like Negate, whereas Murder is like Cancel, you know? And the more specialized version is more interesting from a strategic standpoint and better. I mean, I think Murder is going to end up, like, it'll depend on the context, but it's not always going to be as good as Doomblade. Sometimes it will, but the Doomblade offers some strategic depth where people can't. It doesn't kill everything. It has a weakness, and whenever a card has a weakness, it becomes, you know, more interesting than right. if it just beats everything.
That helps its design. Number six on our list, we have Birds of Paradise. Tell us a little about Birds of Paradise.
So Birds of Paradise, dripping with flavor. It's beautiful. People look at it and it makes them happy. It shows off part of Green's color pie, both the acceleration but also the five-color fixing. After all these years, it's still awesome, and it's always high tier one constructed, but it's not broken. It's like as good as that type of thing could be without being too good. You know, a Noble Hierarch is a little oppressive, and Noble Hierarch only providing three of the colors. I mean, that showed off part of that block, but Birds of Paradise shows off green big picture. Right. You know, like Doomblade shows off that black kills creatures and that it doesn't like to kill its own. Green, Birds of Paradise shows off the acceleration and the fixing, you know? Yeah.
It's hard to imagine a Type 2 without it. And again, you're talking high tier one. It's been one of those things. There's never been a conversation ever in Magic history where it's like, oh, ban Birds of Paradise? Like, is that a thing you can do? No. It's you just kind of, you assume it's there. It's one of your best friends of Magic, and I think it has a lot to do with it. Again, I like the aesthetics of it. It goes a long way.
Yeah, and the fact that cards like this look good to people and are actually good leads to the game being more fun for more people, because it's not, I mean, like, spiky players can love when all the best cards are deceptive, when it's a trick, when you have to figure out that you have to demonic consultate for your card that lets you pay life so that you can, you know, like, some people like that, but the vast majority of people really like if the cards that they were drawn to were actually good, too. They don't always have to be the best, but it's nice if they're actually good, if they can feel good about the fact that, oh, yeah, I like Birds of Paradise. And I like Doomblading my opponent's Birds of Paradise. And both of those things are very reasonable.
Those are good games of Magic. Well, we have a Planeswalker on our list here. Number five, Garrick Wildspeaker.
Yeah, I think a lot of people would question if Planeswalkers even should be in the conversation. But I think the Planeswalkers have proven to be one of the best things for Magic, like long term. The amount of depth they've added and how much they've allowed the game to be focused on creatures. Plus, they're epic. You know, and there's so few of them, and that they're... The time that's spent on them is disproportionately high, so that the designs can come out better. And it's been a little tricky for Wizards to get to the spot where they're making, you know, all the Planeswalkers ideal, because they do push the power level a little too much sometimes. But Garruk is at the perfect power level. He was one of the first five and showed what was possible. And he shows off a variety of elements of Green's color pie. He's fun to play with. He's fun to play against. He's high tier one at times, but wasn't ever broken, and people, like, they look at him and he looks awesome, and then they play with him and he actually is awesome. So I think he was the best of the original bunch and helped usher in an era of Planeswalkers that has been really good for Magic.
Yeah, it's not, you know, you think the Lorwyn cycle of them, they have very vanilla abilities. You think about, they're very straightforward, plus minus and something extreme, and Garrick, again, he captures that beautifully. I think there's no one part of that that feels awkward. There's no one part of that that doesn't feel green. There's no one part of that card that doesn't function a little bit differently to do something different for you in whatever game or state you're in. It's perfect.
And it lets you play with things you wouldn't normally play with. Like, people who don't normally play Overrun get to Overrun sometimes without putting Overrun in their deck. They get to have games where those types of tactical things come up, you know?
Yeah, it was like, oh, this is how this works in Constructed. That's actually kind of good. You got there. Number four on our list, we have Lightning Bolt.
Lightning Bolt, a little pushy on power, and so it's kind of not sure if it belongs on the list, but it's been one of the best things for Magic, reprinting it. And it's good that it left after, but it's a very clean design that just shows off exactly what red does, and it's exciting, and people get, you know, it's a reason to play red, and it captures very much the way red solves problems. It shows off that red's good at fighting small creatures, but not the big ones. It's the easiest card in the world to understand what it does, but there's so much depth to it, particularly now that you can actually hit Planeswalkers. For a card with so little text, it does so many different things and has so many different applications, where it has, you know, impact on formats where people will value creatures that have a 4 toughness specifically because they pass the Bolt test, you know?
Yeah, there's always that kind of that removal spell in the formats, and as many Doomblades as there are, they just don't function the same way as Lightning Bolt does. And Lightning Bolt, again, it fills in a different place. Even kills that Jace from time to time, and in Vintage even. Like, these things come up. It was no dagger. Just
no, like, I know, but every time I picture Jace being lightning bolted, it makes me sad.
It happens. You know, it seems like we've gone over some pretty, I mean, I wouldn't say vanilla cards, but some seemingly basic cards. We're coming into the bottom three, or the top three in this list here. It starts to get a little interesting. You know, number three on our list, Form of the Dragon. Please tell me why.
So, Form of Dragon's a beautiful top-down before Wizards had figured out how to do all these top-downs again. You know, like, Alpha was full of top-downs, and the game had kind of strayed from that a little bit, and I think it was hurting things. Form of Dragon was an early indication, you know, that we can get back to that space, and that's actually a good space to go to. Even though it's a color bleed in a variety of different ways, that is exactly what you would picture. Like, that card captures the idea of, I turn into a dragon myself, you know? Like, you can't get me because I'm up in the air.
Right.
And I'm breathing fire. And I have a 5 toughness because it's like Shivan Dragon, you know?
Yeah.
And
I mean, it's beautiful, and the fact that it was executed the way it was is a huge testament to the way the card works. I think if you change any aspect of it, you kind of cheat the experience.
Yeah, and it's at just the right power level where it's very it's very strong, but it's not broken. And it is a little dangerous where you make cards that are such I wins. Like, Form of Dragon is definitely I win against a lot of people, but you're going to want to make some amount of those. And when you do, having an I win that has a hidden drawback of setting your life down to 5, or that can be removed if you just play with enchantment removal or flyers, or, you know, if you're going to make some I win cards, Form of Dragon is a much better I win card to make than something like, for instance, Blightsteel Colossus, where it's, oh, so if it hits me, I'm dead. Oh. Okay, that's interesting.
Did it hit me? All right. Yeah, it's again, it's something you don't really think about ever. I mean, you just kind of like, oh, Form of the Dragon. Like, that's a very overcusted enchantment. Yeah, it's cool. Like, deal damage, all these things. But really, I mean, I remember
it showed up many times in tournament play. Many times.
That helps it a lot here on this list.
Yes, I think that one of the elements, like, what the perfect card is, has to involve accomplishing its goals, but also being good enough that people actually want to play with it, because cards that people are willing to play in tournaments get to do these things more often, you know? And Giant Spider, I think it's a little bit of a pass just because it's in every limited set, you know?
Yeah, well, like, you'll still play it at the Pro Tours because it's there.
And it's helped define limited at all. You know, like, it was invented before limited was. But, being a competitive card, but also being top down, and elegance is also important. And I realize Form of Dragon isn't always the most elegant, but you can wrap your mind around it. Despite how much text it has, it's real easy to remember what Form of Dragon does.
Right. Number two on our list is probably the best example of the things you just spoke about. Baneslayer Angel is kind of like, you know, the marquee card for the new age of Magic, really.
Yes.
Magic 2010.
Absolutely. Baneslayer Angel was the flagship of the change in the direction of the entire game. You know, Magic before M10 versus Magic afterwards is two completely different animals, and Baneslayer Angel was literally the top billing and showed off so much of these changes. It was engineered to have the perfect set of stats, the perfect cost and everything, where it would be high tier one, it would have an impact, it would be better. Like, people were used to looking at cards that look sweet and being like, oh, it can't really be sweet. And if you look at Baneslayer Angel, everybody when it first came out was like, oh, it can't really be sweet. Nothing's ever sweet, it just dies to Doomblade. But it was the beginning of, actually, yeah, they can be sweet. You know, and Baneslayer Angel is not unbeatable by any means, because at the end of the day, you can still Doomblade it. Like, if you're getting beat by Baneslayer Angel, you can just put some more Doomblades in your deck, and maybe it's not even the right thing to do, but at least you won't lose to Baneslayer Angel anymore. Baneslayer Angel was taking Tarmogoyf, realizing, wow, people were really excited about Tarmogoyf existing, even though the card, people that hated it at first, and it didn't look right to people. It's ugly, it's not aesthetically pleasing, the numbers are weird, it involves all this math, it's complicated. They thought, why don't we make a card that is as epic as Tarmogoyf, but instead of attaching it to some ugly body that that people aren't drawn to, what if we put it on the perfect body? Like, you know, Wizards of the Coast, one of the things they found is that things with wings are really popular among people. And, you know, beautiful women are very popular on cards, like angels in particular. And Baneslayer Angel captured so much of what was right about Sarah Angel, but brought it up to the new standard. So I just think, you know, being able to push the power level that much, but without breaking anything.
It's no, just, again, you look back now and you're like, wow, that elegance was really there. That power level was right there. I mean, I think of, five fives for five might be a dime a dozen in Magic. In competitive Magic, you know, up until that point, that seemed like a lot. It seemed like a barrier you didn't want to cross. It was like, really, you know, this doesn't have a way to protect itself. Is it ever going to be good enough? But it did. It seemed more than enough. And, you know, every once in a while, those other abilities would better.
It's the archetypal. I mean, it's like every creature in Magic is like a Baneslayer or a Moldrifter, where it either just gives you value or it's just sweet. And before Baneslayer, there weren't really a lot of Baneslayers, you know? Like, there were some, but not the same. Baneslayer changed the philosophy for how sweet cards are designed.
Probably like Chameleon Colossus before that?
And part of it is just the Chameleon Colossus had a defensive ability, you know, like protection from black. The
First Strike is a kind of a defensive ability.
I guess protection from demons and dragons.
Oh, wow.
Which also shows off part of M10's, you know, capturing flavor. You know, like, it's okay to spend a few lines to add this game text that makes the card more flavorful, you know?
Yeah, no, it's... I think the line, protection from dragons and demons, like...
It looks sweet to people, even though it's, like, almost flavor text.
Poor Halo Hunter.
I love that they actually engineered a demon specifically so that it would not be able... So that the protection from demons thing would be loud and clear.
Right. You made it very apparent. No, this is... It's good. Look, it's good. Number one, the most elegant, simple, beautiful...
Perfect.
There we have it. Giant Growth.
Giant Growth, been around forever. So few words, so much depth. It shows off so much of Magic's game engine. It shows off, it gives you so many strategic decisions. You can use it for 3 extra damage, or you can save your guy. You can counter their Lightning Bolt. You can make your guy trade up. You can actually attack with all of your creatures, because whichever one they block, you can, you know, the amount of depth and the amount of thinking on the card, despite how simple it is and how easy it is to understand, where people after years of playing Magic are still learning how to better use their Giant Growths. And there's so much to think about because it's never solved. Should you attack with a 2-2 into a 2, with your 2-3 into their 3-3? Like, if you have a Baneslayer Angel and your opponent attacks with Curd Ape, you can't block. He has to have the Giant Growth. Why would he attack with his Curd Ape?
Right.
But then, if he actually doesn't have the Giant Growth, maybe he's doing it anyway because you can't possibly block, because, you know, like, that element of bluffing, that element of gameplay, it's incredible to fit on so few words.
And again, it makes sense. Thing get big.
Absolutely. it's so flavorful too. Like, this thing is now significantly bigger. And it's survived the test of time. You know, like, I realized there was a conspiracy to let Giant Spider win the head-to-head internally at WotC, but Giant Growth has been sweet forever. It's been at the right power level. I mean, it's not dominating constructed play, but it's at this nice power level forever, and it's spawned 60, 70, 80, 100 different variations of it, and there's going to be, you know, more forever.
Right, right. Any other way you can cut it, you will, but... It's just so simple, so easy, and been there for 20 years.
Absolutely. So what do you think about no blue cards on the list?
I think we had a good discussion of this ahead of time. Blue is just, it's too polarized of a color. You're one way or the other. Patrick sat here just racking his brain for as long as he could, thinking, like, where do we meet in the middle? Where do we find something? The options, the choices he had just didn't sit well. They didn't taste right.
I mean, all the cards that sum up what blue is are problematic, you know? Or they're the weaker version, like... You don't get excited about Divination, even though Divination is kind of pushy, simply because the bar is so screwed up from before. You know, like, it's been grandfathered in.
What do you think about the card Inspiration as a Magic card?
It's okay. I like Divination a little bit better, but Inspiration's fine too. It's hard because our perceptions are so anchored. And Divination is pretty close. And Inspiration, I mean, Divination more so just because it's at a better power level. Inspiration's power level's a little low. But it's weird because so many of the blue cards, it's like Inspiration is just a little, or Cancel. Look at Cancel. Cancel, just a hair too weak at 3. it's fine, it's still good, and it's one of the best designed blue cards, but it's still not as good. It's not Doomblade good.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And a lot of the blue cards are like that, where it's like for one mana too little, they're not, like, I think Counterspell's not healthy long term.
Yeah, and
eventually
that,
we could get to that spot, but
no, it's good to, you know, let people at home know that what a huge difference a colorless is in that regard.
Oh, absolutely. And I mean, look at Negate. I think Negate might actually be the perfect Counterspell because it's got that interesting strategic depth, the complexity, but at the same time it has so few words, it's so elegant.
Right.
It's easy to understand.
It was the closest contender to making this list, really. I mean, if you want to, like, what does blue do? And again, in its infancy, blue was magic of the mind. You have these, you know, sleight of minds, you have these magical hacks, and those are effectively do-nothing magic cards.
And then on the other side...
Right, yeah, you have the stuff that's just...
Oh, you so know. Your mechanic is control magic, counterspell, and ancestral recall. Wow, sign me up for that color.
Yeah, the first time I ever played Magic against that deck, I was, I didn't leave mad, but it was more of a sense of, like, wow, I shouldn't have played any of my creatures or cast any of my spells. I might have had a better chance in this game.
Yeah, so I mean, I love blue, obviously, but mostly that's just because drawing cards is like the purpose of being alive. And winning in tournaments is aided by playing with overpowered cards. And blue as a color has always just been overpowered.
That's
so not perfectly designed, because it's... You know.
I do like your ode to blue, though. That's very nice.
No, I mean... Blue is like, sometimes I think that the other four colors are just a vessel to be able to experience the color blue. Like, there needs to be context. If everything was blue, nothing would be blue. It would, you know, it'd be meaningless.
Right, right.
But because there are the other colors, we all eventually reach the point in our lives where we realize we're blue mages. Not everybody has reached that point yet, but eventually you do. And even if it takes many lifetimes, eventually you realize you're a blue mage.
I'll give you that one. Well, there you have it. Top 8 perfect Magic cards. For Patrick Chapin, I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here on The Magic Cruise. You're watching Magic TV. I like saying that. And thanks for watching. Just like Mr. Tabak's about to do. You got a list for me?
No.
Top 8 layers. Start at the top.
First one, personal favorite, layer 3.
I thought you were just going to do them in order.
Order?
This is a chance for them to learn the layers.
True. Let's start from the top.
Today, kids, we're going to learn about layers.